We are on a journey, showcasing the rich biodiversity we have been cherishing over the millenniums. The colorful world of birds and wildlife. Earth as magnificent as the mountains and streams make up these thriving forests. Yet we have failed to protect them, blindly climbing the ladder of non-sustainable development. Our story begins here in the forests around Nainital in the Himalayan region of Uttarakhand. This region has about 300 species of birds on record alongside wildlife. Suitable elevation and pleasant weather throughout the year has made these forests a favorable habitat for a varied species of birds, including several migratory and a variety of resident birds. The beginning of summers is the most preferred time of the year for mating. This arises a need for nesting in the months to follow. Birds use different types of nest with a distinct architecture to best suit their needs. This one likes to hang up by the branches. Fondly known as the helmet bird, long-tailed broadbill builds a dangling pear-shaped nest that hangs by the branches. Turquoise blue tail, they wag incessantly and are brightly visible even from distances. A few are born without or might have lost one, which they still try to wag as an inherent characteristic feature. It is not an easy task picking up the right materials for nesting, especially when there are so many options. Dry leaves, pine needles and tiny sticks. This tailless broadbill is no less a champ. To begin with, slender branches of a tree are tied together to put down a foundation for the nest. Both the genders actively participate in the process of nest building. Once the basic structure is built, she wants to make sure of having a reasonable space for eggs, which indeed is the primary concern for nesting. Another round of auditing further reveals a few more shortcomings. Ultimately, the broad bill seems to be pretty content with the architecture. Perhaps cross-checking is a necessity before the final laying of eggs. Now that the construction is complete, the nest needs safeguarding against the intruders. The forest becomes warm and welcoming during summers, with numerous nests within. Livestock and modern lifestyles are becoming a threat to these new homes due to excessive deforestation. Comfort and convenience make younger trees an easy target. The intrusion of humans into the forest has left these innocent lives with no choice but to abandon their homes. With all the commotion and disturbance being caused, will this place remain hospitable to birds? Remains a question. Having said that, life in these forests is no less active. Varied forms of life are active during different hours of the day. As the sun goes down, it's time the nocturnals arise. A good day begins with a good breakfast. So the hunt begins. And the young pheasants make a substantial dose of energy. Spot-bellied eagle owls, similar to others of their kind, have a routine of sleeping or staying inactive during the day. This is sometimes hampered because of particular circumstances. Having a juvenile to take care of is one of them. A new world, a new life brings out the curiosity in the juvenile to explore and learn things just like any other newborn. After a tiring session, trees and breeze sing him a lullaby. Looks like even the sleep doesn't come easy in the wild because of these red flies. The only way to get rid of such flies is for these birds to preen themselves quite regularly. Since the nest is not forever and now out of his comfort zone, he wants to reach out for his parents above the canopy. Fear of the unexplored path makes it hard for the chick to venture out of his usual surroundings. He dares to jump. When one is resolute to reach the goal, it doesn't matter how hard the path is. His incapacity to fly makes it tougher to scale the upward trail against the gravity. Every effort cannot fetch the desired result. The parent owls decide to stay back and watch. This pushes the chick to learn to tackle the obstacles on his own. Failure indeed is the stepping stone to success, but only when one is determined enough not to give up. As the saying goes, experience is the best teacher. The smart one is more careful and cautious now. Exercising his every step with more attention, he realizes that slow and steady wins the race, hence not rushing but taking matters easy. After all these efforts, he deserves a fruitful reward, which is why his neighbors await to welcome him on board. Owls are less preferred as neighbors and are often pestered. One reason for such a dislike is having juveniles who are vulnerable to becoming their prey. Responsibility as a parent doesn't end with the feeding alone, rather extends to the safety of the chicks too. All of which can come to an end after a certain period. The juveniles will have to start living on their own. Being on the treetop doesn't end his constraints. There are hardships to be faced at every stage of life. Surviving in the wild is indeed a quest in itself. New lives flourish the forest with the onset of spring. Hunger is one of the primary concerns that need caring, and the mother is always at the service. Apparently, only one chick can be fed at a time, keeping others waiting and wanting for more. Training the juveniles with the right etiquettes is an important part of their growth. The parent Rongos surely knows how to discipline their chicks. One right stare at the right moment plays all the trick. Space they share becomes a constraint as the chicks grow. As they start getting out, swinging on the branches becomes their favorite pastime. Feeding is not limited to the nest. Wherever the chicks go, mothers follow. A few species have evolved to share spaces with humans. They are used to the human world, such as traffic, commotion, and a lot of crowds around. As the name implies, barn swallow typically nests inside accessible buildings such as barns and stables or under bridges. Before man-made sites became common, they nested on cliff faces or in caves, but this is now rare. Streams have been lifelines of the ecosystems throughout. They are a source of drinking water and housing several creatures. Those who stay under the rocks and others above them. Being attentive from the birds and that too from top of the rocks is quite a task. One of the possible threats include Himalayan keelbacks, which are mildly venomous. They prefer open woodlands, and since they are strong swimmers, are found close to fresh water too. Their major diet includes amphibians, especially the common toad and frog. Stream is a food basket, providing kingfishers with an ample amount of food. Skills and patience are the characteristics required to get a hold of the prey. Since it must eat around 60% of its body weight each day, it is essential to have a control over a suitable stretch of water. Their close cousin has adopted a different strategy. The wide-breasted kingfisher feeds on young birds, amphibians, and small reptiles. While the biggest of them, crested kingfisher, sticks on to the traditional methods of fishing. The key to which is long hours of observation and stalking before launching an attack. Bathing is an integral part of the bird's routine. This is again facilitated by the streams. Shikra seems quite acquainted of his neighbor's dislike for him, while he cleanses himself cautiously. One of the uncommon birds of the magpie family, also a rarer one, is the common green magpie. This bird's diet takes a very high percentage of animal prey from countless insects, small reptiles, mammals to young birds and eggs. This juvenile of the common green magpie has been instructed to maintain silence. As usual, no kid ever listens to their parents. Their continuous calls seek the attention of a hostile neighbor, leading to the exact thing which the parents feared. Becoming a victim of the hawk eagle's feast. The only survivor among the siblings decided to take a journey of lookout for his mom all by himself. This also calls for him to be cautious of his surroundings alongside the search. Initial calls of his mother gets him excited. Reunion with his mother is a reward for his efforts. He enjoys being under the cover of his mother's care, but oblivious to how long will it last. Variation in seasons lead to varied water levels too. summers are the driest months of the year. Water seeps in through rocks and gets accumulated at certain places, which in turn becomes a picnic spot among the villagers. Color of the water body changes by the noon. Reason for such a phenomenal occurrence are we humans alone. Streams turn out to be of multi-purpose for the humans, becoming a center of rejuvenation, refreshment, as well as religion. This leads to all the littering around. Whatever may be the reason for littering, results are all the same. It gets harder for the aquatic residents to survive. The life remaining is taken away by a few other greedy beings. Usage of such harsh chemicals for fishing affect all marine beings fatally. The scarcity of water and food in these extreme summers have affected the new sprung life of birds. As always, the parents are there to care a little too much. Dad delivers a bigger bite than the chick's capacity to swallow. He surely can spit it out as soon as the dad decides to leave. Indian paradise flycatchers are the summer visitors of this region. These birds are, as the name suggests, insectivores, feeding on a variety of insects. Chicks enjoy their togetherness also through the process of preening, which sometimes turn out to be a contest. Self-declaration is the only option when there is nobody to judge. It's quite a task for the parents to feed the juveniles at brief intervals and also to remain energetic all throughout. Dad is astonished to find a single chick on his return. He starts calling and looking out as he's aware of the possible threats around. Mother also joins the search to relieve her partner. Eventually, the juvenile is found sitting on a branch, starving. His mother reassures him of his refuge by feeding him. Father also comes down to comfort the chick. Feeding is not the only task. Collecting the droppings too is. It's funny how at times the task goes to an extreme level that the droppings are hogged from touching the ground. At certain places, color of the stream has changed drastically. Marine life is almost non-existent. All that can be seen are disgusting formations of human waste. Carelessness and ignorance for nature has resulted in an unorganized waste management. Over the years, the rapidly rising population of the town, along with some major establishments, has caused a negative impact on the natural surroundings.
At a garbage dump, every day there's food available in large quantities, and it's very attractive for animals to come and feed there because they know there's some food available there every day. Waste ends up in natural habitats, be it rivers or edges of forest. Even urban waste ends up in the nearest forest habitat, which we think is, you know, wasteland, or it's koi bahar rehta nahi hai. Humans don't stay there, so we go and dump it there. It's home to other creatures, but we don't seem to care about that. And these animals then come to feed there. And there's a whole set of things happening when they come to feed there. Okay. Animals behave differently. Okay. Some animals, like monkeys, which have hands like us, are able to open up the last plastic bag there, tear it open. They don't ingest plastic that often, monkeys, because they have hands like us. Whereas if you look at birds, which have sharp beaks, okay, not all birds, but the ones with sharp beaks, which can peck, okay, they go through trash very carefully, like they go through leaf litter, and they will pull out food, be it insects or chips or some kitchen waste. And they'll only eat that. Again, they don't ingest plastic. They're not at such high risk. But the ones at risk are animals that lack sharp beaks or hands. This includes a whole range of species. This includes your cow, your dog, civets, sambar deer, cheetal deer, mongooses. Animals have their own like behaviors. They live in societies. They move in certain ways. Okay, they're not static. They're not just sitting in one place, right? Now what happens when there's trash, an attractive resource, and everybody is coming there, okay? So their daily movement patterns have changed. Instead of going around a lot, they now come straight to one place. They're moving less. They're getting fat on our waste. And they're also ingesting a lot of toxic stuff, be it plastics. We often find nails, syringes. They're getting a lot of nutritious food. They're also getting a lot of toxic food at garbage dumps, okay? So it changes the societal structure in very, very complex ways. The more we habituate them to human food, the more we mess up their societies. The more conflict we cause even within their own societies, within animal societies, and also between humans and animals. So it's got fairly complex impacts, the way in which human trash is being entering ecosystems today.
This is a leopard cat that was found close to the market area where there was a garbage pileup. We tried to get her medicated with some help of the forest department and a few local villagers, only to find our efforts in vain. The severity of her infection didn't let her survive for more than a couple of days from then.
In Uttarakhand, we have many cases of plastic being found stuck in the intestine of leopards, and the leopard being found in a very weak and starved out condition when it's found dead. We don't know what killed it, but plastic possibly led to its intestine getting choked and eventually the animal starving to death. Okay. There's multiple other things that happen as a result of it. When bears, leopards, elephants come to garbage dumps regularly, they're coming out of the forest to the edge and close to human habitats. As a result, you know, the conflict with humans go up. they end up more often in human areas.
हमारी कितनी बकरी मार दी कितना क्या घर से उठा के ले जा रहा बकरी बड़ा परेशान कर रखा है ये बाघों ने वहाँ तो बहुत ही परेशान कर रखा है
अच्छी खासी पख्या थी ले गया दोनों को एक पहले दिन ले गया एक तीसरे दिन ले गया एक ये करके ले गया
बाहर तो खट्टी मारी दो अलग अलग मारी जानवरों को भी पालना कठिन है घास कहाँ चला है ये
बाघ मार देता है कुछ वो बीमारी से मर जाते हैं लेकिन करे क्या काम करना है तो फिर डरना क्या करना ही करना है आजीविका चलानी है तो अपनी
नहीं अब हम गरीब आदमी है हमारा कोई रोजगार नहीं कुछ नहीं यह ऐसा खेती बाड़ी इतनी है इसी से अपना जरिया गुजर डर
दूसरा कोई है ही नहीं इस जगह में कोई काम है ही नहीं यहाँ पर
Even though the possibilities are quite marginal, humans end up as victims too, because of factors like fear and defensive character of the wildlife, or even easy approachability, such as young kids.
मैं घर को आता रोड से ऊपर को घर पहुंचना लाई था आगे मेरे तो एकदम अटैक करा पीछे से हाँ यहाँ पकड़ा दबाया मेरे को रास्ते में नीचे फेंका खेत में उनके पूरी औंगली पूछ रही थी
हम उठे तो खिड़की वड़की दरवाजे खोले लाइट लगाई यहाँ पर लंबा हुआ ठहरा
एक तो हुई बेहोश हो गई
मैंने कहा ओहो इसका तो आज काम हो गया ये
इसने यही कहा मेरे को बाल सकुट गया बस इतना फिर नहीं बोला इसने कहा मेरे को देख लो आज ही आज हूँ मेरे को देख
अम्मी सुबह
को नहीं देख पाओगे
पड़ता जैसा अलग निकाला
ये बेहोशी हो गए मैं बेहोशी कौन ठहरा
क्या पता हमको उम्मीद तो नहीं थी बिल्कुल मुझे तो नहीं थी मैंने कहा कहाँ को ले जा रहे हो यार ये खाली ये मरा आदमी को कहाँ ले जा रहे हो
तुम पीठ में चिंग रहे थे अभी हाथों में थे ये हमसे जान में थे अब तो सही हो रहा है सर में थे आठ नौ टांके ऑपरेशन हुआ फिर दूसरे दिन अब तो सही फिट
There was a rescue operation of the leopard found stuck on an iron wire near the stream area of the town. The incidents came to light because this part of the stream is in regular accessibility of local people, who along with the forest department succeeded in rescuing this big cat. The irony is that the reason that led to his discovery might have been the cause of his agony too. Almost a year later, another leopard was found dead under similar circumstances, but in the denser part of the forest. Why were there metal wires at such places? Were these leopard traps a coincidence or intentional? Answers to these can be only left to imagination.
Pretty serious the situation in our ecosystems today, but I just have a bit of hope that we, as in the next generation, will be more responsible than the previous one. Next, and we'll all wake up to this crisis that's facing us and the environment. It's a joint crisis. It's not just the environment that's struggling; it's us as well. And we'll go and do something about this together. I just am hopeful. I don't know if I'm being stupid, but I'm just hopeful.
The first step of any change is awareness. Sculpting young minds through such awareness and acceptance of need for change is crucial. An NGO named Waste Warriors is doing just that.
और इसको कितना टाइम लगता है डालने में? 70 से 80 साल लगते हैं। ये पतला है थोड़ा। 70 से 80 साल लगते हैं इसको। और 70 से 80 ए बातें करना मत। 70 से 80 साल बहुत कम नहीं होता हमारी मतलब एक चिप्स पैकेट खाया तो ये हमारी लाइफ लॉन्ग रहेगा एक पैकेट
मैंने सबसे ज़्यादा जो अंतर देखा जो बदलाव देखा मैंने बच्चों में देखा तो क्योंकि हम रेगुलर स्कूल में जा रहे हैं स्कूल में वेस्ट कलेक्शन भी हो रहा है स्कूल में अवेयरनेस ज़्यादा हो रही है तो बच्चे आज की डेट में अवेयर हैं अपने माँ बापों से उनसे वो जिन जिन स्कूलों में हम जाके अवेयर कर रहे हैं या जिन गाँव में हैं वहाँ के बच्चे थोड़ा नहीं फेंक रहे हैं वो लोग अगर चिप्स भी खा रहे हैं, टॉफ़ी खा रहे हैं, तो अपना वेस्ट को एटलीस्ट वो अपने जेब में रखते हैं, जब डस्टबिन मिलता है तब डस्टबिन में डालते हैं। प्लस कुछ गेम्स होते हैं जिसकी वो भी वेस्ट से रिलेटेड गेम होते हैं और टीम वर्क के गेम होते हैं, वो सिखाते हैं ताकि उनके अंदर टीम वर्क बिल्डिंग हो, और क्राफ्ट सिखाते हैं, वेस्ट से क्राफ्ट बनाना सिखाते हैं।
Rewarding part of our work is visiting the schools because at least they listen to you, at least they're excited for you to be there and do your craft and do your game. They appreciate us. Nobody else seems to appreciate us for the kind of work that we do. And yes, if we keep on with this for the next 25 years, I can give it in writing that after 25 years, their village will be clean. It's very, very rewarding. Today you see kids talking about segregation, they're wanting to help you clean their school.
अलग अलग डस्टबिन में अलग अलग प्रकार के कूड़े डाले हैं, और हमें जहाँ तक लगता है कि हम पहले हमारा विद्यालय ही साफ़ नहीं है तो हमारा गांव कहाँ साफ होगा। तो
हमें बोलना चाहिए, हम लोग बोलते ही नहीं किसी से, डर जाते हैं हम खुद ही, अगर हम बोलेंगे तभी तो सब करेंगे।
अपने स्कूल को हमेशा साफ रखना चाहिए।
उसके बाद हम बड़ों से मिलते हैं, प्रधान जी से मिलते हैं, इन सब लोगों से मिलते हैं और उन लोगों के साथ डिस्कस करते हैं कि अब देखो हम आपके गांव में वेस्ट वॉरियर्स ही काम करने वाला है, तो उनको प्रॉपर अवेयरनेस करते हैं कि क्यों प्लास्टिक को जलाना नहीं है, क्यों नहीं फेंकना है, फूड वेस्ट से खाद कैसे बनाना है।
There are already ladies from different villages who've been identified, the informal self-help groups who've been trained by our team. They go on weekly waste collection. All homes are provided with a bag where they put in their dry waste. We don't take wet waste. Luckily, we've been very lucky. Villages don't really need too much of a system for wet waste. You just have to tell them how to compost it. Normally, they all have horticulture waste and it's easy. So the ladies collect all the dry waste. They go to a storeroom, and there are storerooms, little rooms hired in different villages where they further go and sort out that waste.
सो स्टोर में आने के बाद वो सारा कूड़ा छटता है, छटने में लगभग 17 से 20 प्रकार की क्वालिटी बनती है, तो उन हर एक कूड़े को अलग कर दिया जाता है। उस सारे कूड़े में से केवल 5% ऐसा होता है जो फेंकने लायक होता है, जो रिसाइकलेबल नहीं होता है, जिसका कोई भी यूज़ नहीं हो सकता, और बाकी सारा का सारा कूड़ा रिसाइकलेबल से है जिसका इस्तेमाल हो सकता है। सो कुछ कूड़ा जो होता है हमारे लोकल में बिक जाता है, लोकल के कबाड़ी वाले ले लेते हैं, कुछ कूड़ा है जो अभी हम हमारे आसपास नहीं बिक रहा है, उसको कोई उसका रिसाइकलर नहीं मिल रहा है, जैसे उसमें चिप्स पैकेट है, पोलिथीन है, टेट्रापैक्स है, थर्मोकोल है, तो उनको अभी हमने स्टोर किया है। लगभग पिछले 5 साल में हमने 10,000 किलो से भी ज़्यादा इस पोलिथीन और चिप्स पैकेट इकट्ठी कर ली है, और हम इंतज़ार कर रहे हैं कि धीरे धीरे कभी ना कभी वो रिसाइकल होगी।
मैन्युफैक्चरर्स रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर देयर प्रोडक्ट, so already there's a rule coming to place where, and it is the effect of organizations like ours who are going on and on saying, look at what they are producing, look at the plastic they are producing. Only when our data is showcased and broadcasted will awareness be spread. My research shows that till every home includes hotels, shop, dhaba, office, every unit that has a human establishment, till every one of them does not have a door-to-door waste collection system. Matlab, someone knocks on their door, asks for their waste, they put it in a bag, and the waste is taken away. Till that does not happen everywhere in rural India, we will never become clean. Also, research shows that if you put public dustbins, however small, maybe it's a 5-house village also, the moment you put a public dustbin, nobody respects that public dustbin. Nobody segregates waste. So actually the Bible to waste collection or waste management is everybody must segregate their waste. Once we start segregating, we will ourselves see the value of that waste. Because we're like, oh, okay, this is not kachara anymore. I can do this, I can do that, and blah, blah, blah. So first rule number one is segregate your waste, and then you will yourself see the value in it.
We talk about making Earth a home for everyone. Perhaps forget that the trash we dump out of our homes land up in somebody else's. The only way to tackle the catastrophic future before it's too late is by realizing that we humans cannot live alone. Rather, we are dependent on nature. So we must let go of the selfishness, the superiority over the other beings, thereby choosing to live in harmony.